Israel self-replicating beta peptides. Please.
Yes, thank you. Hello, everybody. I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to talk here. The title of my talk will be Self-Replication of Beta Sheet Peptides. This is a relatively new system that we studied recently. What should I do to move it?
Previous
is the next. Okay, thank you. So since we are in rather late stages of the meeting, I think I don't have to introduce the concept of self-replication in here and the importance of self-replication for the origin of life and abiotic life. But I want just to mention that self-replication, minimal self-replication systems were developed with all kinds of different molecules, including DNA, RNA, peptides, and small molecules. And that I don't want to get into the discussion of which one is more relevant to the origin of life, but to say that from the conceptual point of view and experimental point of view, they are all interesting. And I'm going to talk mainly about peptide self-replication. And with peptide self-replication, I guess that most of you already know this system that can replicate, which is based on the coiled coil peptides, these alpha helical peptides, in which in one configuration that we use, a dimeric coiled coil can serve as a template for association of two shorter peptides, which due to their close proximity can react to give a new peptide. If this peptide is the same as one of the mother peptides, then this process is autocatalytic, but for the same with the same principle, we can do also a template-assisted cross-catalysis, where the template peptide will enhance the formation of a different peptide, usually a mutant of the original peptide. And if you do all of this together, what you can get is a replication network. And this is something we have been studied a few years ago. The formation of a replicating network. What you see here is a diagram in which each peptide at it's an arrow tail. It's known that an arrow tail can serve as a catalyst for the formation of a peptide at the arrowhead. So this is the network that we form, the replication network that we form. It features some interesting things. For example, it is replicable, meaning that the entire network can replicate. It presents networking features, like more complex networks. For example, you can see the hub that connects many different molecules. You can see a reciprocal replication, and you can also dissect the network to different modules. More than that, we were able to show that network modules can serve for molecular computation. We did this both experimentally and theoretically, and that the same network can also show some adaptivity. For example, we studied recently the response of the network to light-induced replication. So this is not the main topic of this talk, so you can go and find it in other places. So mainly with this alpha helix system, we were interested in the following question. Can we develop synthetic molecular assembly that function as cell mimetics, meaning that it can feature complex dynamic behavior and molecular functionality, where we had the inspiration and the challenges taken from cellular networks, from protein networks. But we can also ask another question, and this is the following question. Can we find a different molecule, a much simpler peptide that can also replicate? And for that matter, we suggest a system that is based on beta sheet. You can see it here. This is a system is made of much shorter sequences. In the one example is a 13 amino acid sequence. Of course, it is much more relevant if we think about prebiotic synthesis of peptides, right? We heard a lecture by Sutherland about the attempts to synthesize short oligomers of RNA. We know the work of Robert Pascal to condense amino acid to form peptides. So you can assume that this is much more readily prevents the beta sheet from expanding in the Y and Z direction. So we take this peptide, we simply modify it a little bit to have the ligation site in the middle, and we have the experimental system. So our experimental system will have peptide number one as the template, one electrophilic and one nucleophilic structure, and we want to learn their autocatalytic properties. And you can see here how we follow the formation of peptide one over time from its precursor. And what you can see that during the first steps of the reaction proceeds linearly and rather slow. Once peptide 1 is formed, it can participate in the reaction as a template, and the reaction speeds up. And this is always the lag phase and the first part of the sigmoidal plot of an autocatalytic process. If we take a mutant peptide, which was mutated in two positions with glycine instead of the glutamic acid, which this peptide cannot form beta sheet and thus cannot replicate, and it is formed from its precursors only linearly. And most typical experiment to show autocatalytic process is to follow the kinetic of the reaction when seeding with different amounts of preformed template. And this is what we did here. You see that the more template we put into the reaction, the faster the reaction, and with about 40% mole catalyst, this is here 40% mole catalyst, what we can get is about two orders of magnitude, rate enhancement, two orders of magnitude rate enhancement relative to the background reaction. So this was very satisfied, so we can form a new, totally new system based on different mode of self-assembly, which can replicate rather nicely. But what we saw is that the kinetics of this self-replicating system is rather different than what we usually see when we do, for example, the molecular self-replication, when we did with the coiled-coils structures, or when people do it with DNA, for example, we see here that the reaction starts fast and then slows down at certain point. And this certain point, when it slows down, is after some time, regardless of what was the amount of peptides that we put in there, or almost regardless of the amount of peptide that we put in there. Unlike the molecular self-replication, where we see that the slow phase comes due to product inhibition after we reach certain concentration of the product. So this was totally different. And what this told us, this result told us, is that probably something else is happening there. There is another mechanism that competes with what we usually follow with the HPLC, and something else is formed, which after some time inhibits the reaction. So we did a rather thorough study to see what is going on with the template over time, and we did it mainly by the cryo-EM, but also with other methods too, to follow what is happening with the peptide over time. The experiment went the following. At time zero, we just take our solution, sonicate it very harshly to break everything to monomers, and then we follow with the cryo-EM the solution at different time, freeze it and follow at different time. So at the time zero, we have monomers. After about 15 minutes, we get beta plate. After 30 minutes, we get these nice fibers. And after, in longer time, we get the nanotubes. Now, we wanted to correlate the profile, the kinetic profile of a template self-assembly with the kinetic profiles of the replication. And this is the experiment that we did in here. And what we can see here is the following. If we take high concentration of template, let's start from the low concentration. If we take low concentration of template, about 30 micromolar, and we wait 20 minutes or 1 hour after sonication, and then initiate the reaction, the rate increases with the time that we wait. But if we take higher concentration of template, And wait 0, 20, or 1 hour after sonication, what we see is that 20 minutes after sonication, this can serve as a very good template and enhance the reaction, while 1 hour after sonication, if this stands 1 hour after sonication, then it's a much lousy template. And the reason for that, we can account for the fact that after 1 hour, all of it became the hollow nanotube, which is not catalytic anymore. So the conclusion from this kinetic study is the following. The monomer, the initial stage of the monomer, and the final stage, which is the hollow nanotube, are not catalytically active, while these two species, the beta plate and the fibers, are catalytically active. And this is and this finding is important for two reasons. First of all, we were able to show that a simple peptide can also replicate, provided that it forms supramolecular structures. But there is another condition here. These supramolecular structures, are only transiently alive, only transiently available. The catalysis should take place when the active supramolecular structure is available for the solution. And then another conclusion from here, since we saw all of these nanostructures, which are in our case are all aromatic, one can easily think that the very same structure can now also chelate, can bind different molecules that are of interest for other applications, but also for binding molecules relevant to the region of life. And just one slide for the future. We want to go to an even simpler, system where we can get rid of this artificially put in a ligation site and just condense the electrophile and nucleophile directly. I think we can do it. And I want to end by thanking the people that did the work, these people here in red, the funding agency, and I want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Donald.